Now our public speaker is speaking from a speech plan community. This is his fourth speech. His project title is Show What You Mean. His objective from the beginning is to learn the values of judgment, body movement as part of the speech, to explore the different ways of using body language, to develop a sense of time and natural smooth body movement. He has requested 7 to 10 minutes. The title of his speech is America Should Demand More Bang for Its Buck. Please put your hands together for James Solomon, who will be giving a speech that you sadly like will never hear from a politician. James Solomon.
Distinguished guests, fellow Toastmasters. If you're going to wage war on someone or something, it goes without saying that you should never lose sight of what you're fighting for. Because if you forget what you're fighting for, the war that you're fighting has already been lost. I know of one such war, a war that as I speak in this year tonight is currently being waged in cities and on streets all across. I'm talking about the war on drugs. And this war has been raging in America for more than 40 years. In fact, it was President Richard Nixon who in 1971 declared that public enemy number one was illegal drugs. And that it was absolutely necessary for us to engage in all our offensive to combat this enemy. The war on drugs was started. And we've been fighting it ever since. I'm not going to stand here and say that I disagree with everything that Mr. Nixon was saying. I'm sure we would all agree that drugs have destroyed countless lives in America. But let's put it in perspective. Let's ask ourselves where we are 40 years later. If we look at all the money we have spent over the years for things like prisons and probational officers, judges, narcotics agents, on interdiction, and a laundry list of other things that have expanded due to the war on drugs. Yes, it does serve to gratify us. It makes us feel as though we're being tough on crime. But will this ever provide a means to an end? We jail more people in this country than any other country on the planet. More than Saudi Arabia, more than China, more than Russia. No other country is imprisoning their population at the rate that we do. Still, drugs are becoming more available than ever before, more pure than ever before, and children of younger and younger ages are willing to sell them. If the status quo was working, I'm sure people would at least hesitate to question it. But it's not working. In fact, since 1971, we have spent over $1 trillion on this war. We've made over 45 million arrests. What's more, during that entire time, the rate of illegal drug use remains unchanged. We now have 2.3 million prisoners packing our prisons. The United States only makes up 5% of the world's population, but we house 25% of its prisoners. Over 500,000 of those prisoners are being incarcerated for non-violent drug crimes. And let me assure you that as in any other war, there is innocent casualties along the way. The casualties of this war are the 2.7 million children that now have a parent who is behind bars of no fault of his own. Unfortunately, these children are more likely to come to prison in their lifetimes. Thus, ensuring in crime. I should at least give Mr. Nixon a little credit, because when he started his war on drugs, he had the foresight to allocate 2/3 of the money to fight things like addiction and rehabilitation. His ideas were most certainly progressive, if we compare him with the people who would come after. Mr. Nixon saw that he was making more progress when he was fighting things like addiction than he was ever making with all of his police efforts. Sadly, this way of thinking seems to be a thing of the past. And it will be one of the biggest problems facing America today. And here's why. When budgets are being trimmed all across the country, people are most certainly still demanding that we buy things like handcuffs and cell doors and build new prisons. We have to remain tough on crime. But the things that we're cutting are all the treatment programs. And in reality, if we're cutting all the treatment programs, the inmates are coming in and leaving just as they were received. And therein lies the problem. Because now people have a vested interest in the war on drugs. And it's byproduct of mass incarceration. Whole communities are now dependent upon a prison or a jail in their town. If you build it, they will come, to be a sell slogan for every private prison owner as they face building their prison all across the country. It has become a self-fulfilling prophecy. We are now so dependent on the prison systems in this country to provide jobs and profit that it's becoming impossible for us to ever scale down our prison population because we have made an industry out of our prisons. The truth of the matter is, when the war on drugs started, I don't know if there was an ethical premise behind it, or if people were genuinely trying to make a difference. But it seems apparent now that we have lost sight of whatever it is we were trying to accomplish. What drugs in America could not destroy, the war on drugs have. What lays in its wake is the countless families that have been torn apart. The puzzle that is the American dream lays before us in pieces, and it will take tough choices and courageous individuals who are not afraid to go against the status quo and forever going to put it back together again. We can't keep tearing families apart. We've got to figure out ways to strengthen them. Strong, loving families will be one of our biggest assets to start making real, tangible progress on this so-called war on drugs. This is and will be one of the biggest crises facing the American people in this 21st century. But don't give up all faith. Because united, we can stand and have a fighting chance. But if we remain divided, we will most certainly continue to fall. Mr. Toastmasters.
One more round of applause for Mr. James Solomon. You are not here after the politics. Please give him another round of applause. Now I'd like you to take 1 to 2 minutes to evaluate Mr. James Solomon's speech.